This is side two of Tumultuous Times, continuing on page number 13. Chapter 2, First Council of Constantinople, 381 A.D.
Your reader for this section is Fred Dawson.
This council was held during the pontificate of Pope St. Damascus I. Background. Unfortunately, the First Council of Nicaea was not successful in eradicating Arianism. This was chiefly due to the machinations of the Arian bishop Eusebius of Nicomedia. He persuaded Constantine's favorite sister, Constantina, to ask emperor, as she lay dying, to restore the exiled heretical bishops to their formal sees, 328 A.D. 2 years later, Constantine became a defender of Arianism after the heretic deceived him with a false profession of faith. The Arian heresy, by then a popular religion, spread like wildfire throughout the empire among bishops, priests, and laity. Saint Athanasius, circa 297-373 AD, was a young deacon from Alexandria who attended the First Council of Nicaea in 325 AD with his bishop, Saint Alexander. Following the death of the bishop in 328 AD, Saint Athanasius was chosen to fill the vacant see. The new bishop refused the imperial command of Constantine to restore Arius to his former position in Alexandria. As a consequence, he aroused the undying hatred of the Arian party, and they did all they could from that time forward to make life as miserable as possible for him. Protected by the emperor, Arians remained in power and persecuted all who opposed them. Saint Athanasius relates in his History of the Arians the sufferings endured by those who remained Catholic. Clergy and laity were banished, robbed or forced to labor in stone quarries, and 26 bishops were exiled or killed. The priest Dioscoros and Hierax, together with 16 bishops from Egypt and Libya, were apprehended and exiled. Many died on the journey. Soon afterward, St. Athanasius had to answer trumped-up charges of murder, treason, and magic at Tyre and Constantinople. He was easily vindicated. However, because Constantine believed additional slanderous stories about him, St. Athanasius was exiled to Trier, Germany, in 336 A.D. The courageous bishop lived in exile in various places for 17 years. Some voices of the time rose up saying that it was Athanasius against the world. Athanasius held the fortress of orthodoxy almost unaided against the world. He held it against the heretical bishops, priests, and laymen, and even against the powerful Emperor Constantine. The Arians made numerous attempts on his life, and he only avoided being murdered by hiding himself for 5 years in a dry well where he was fed by one of his friends, who was the only person that knew the place of his concealment. With the church of both East and West cowed into submission, Constantine attacked Athanasius. The Dux Syrianus was ordered to assemble the legions of Egypt and Syria and remove the bishop from Alexandria. On the night of February the 8th, 356, imperial troops broke into the church of Theonis, where Athanasius, surrounded by his clergy and consecrated virgins, was conducting a vigil service. As the arrows flew and the dead and wounded fell, his clergy hurried to the reluctant bishop from his throne, and Athanasius dropped completely from sight. In the next year, George of Cappadocia ceremoniously entered the sullen city to be enthroned as the new bishop. He soon released a reign of terror against Athanasius' supporters, while on the side organizing profitable monopolies in pork, salt, and papyrus. And in the desert, moving from one hiding place to another, welcomed by monks, never once betrayed by his people, Athanasius remained the religious leader of Egypt, pouring out a steady flood of well-informed books and pamphlets defending the Nicene faith. Cardinal Newman relates that during this period, Catholic churches were desecrated and cemeteries were ransacked. Furthermore, the Arian Bishop George of Cappadocia brought out some of the consecrated virgins and threatened them with death by burning unless they forthwith turned Arians. On perceiving their constancy of purpose, he stripped them of their garments and beat them so barbarously on the face that for some times afterwards their features could not be distinguished. Of the men, 40 were scourged, some died of wounds, and the rest were banished. Not long after, however, Athanasius was again obliged to flee, owing to the persecution he suffered from Julian, the apostate, who was instigated by the Arians. On one occasion, when he was being pursued by the emperor's satellites, who were ordered to put him to death, the saint ordered the boat in which he was fleeing from danger to be turned back. As soon as he met the persecutors, they asked him if Athanasius was anywhere near. He answered that he was not far off. Whilst they, therefore, went one way, he sailed the other way and got back to Alexandria, where he remained in concealment until Julian's death. Another storm soon arose in the city, and he was obliged to hide himself for 4 months in his father's sepulchre. Having thus miraculously escaped from all these great dangers, he died peacefully in his own bed at Alexandria on May 2, 373 A.D., during the reign of Emperor Valens. The situation was desperate, nevertheless. Christ protected his church and ultimately triumphed over the heretics. God raised up valiant saints to vigorously oppose the inroads of heresy. The greatest of these was Saint Athanasius. The feat of Athanasius is astounding. Clear-headed, intuitive, and indomitable, he looms across the distance of history like another Abraham, the man in whom the future resided and who stood alone. Saint Ambrose of Milan. Saint Ambrose, circa 340 to 397 AD, replaced the Arian bishop Auxentius, who had ruled for 20 years. At the Council of Sirmium in 378 AD, Ambrose, supported by the young Emperor Gratian, deposed 6 Arian bishops in a series of laws in 379 and 380. Gratian, under Ambrose's tutelage, proscribed Arianism in the West. In his exposition of the gospel, he strongly condemns heresy. We are to understand that heretics and schismatics are also severed from the kingdom of God and from the church. And so Christ makes it clearly evident that every assembly of heretics and schismatics belongs not to God, but to the unclean spirit. In 385 AD, St. Ambrose was summoned to the imperial palace by Emperor Valentinian II and his mother, the Empress Justina, who was an Arian, and ordered to give churches to the Arians. St. Ambrose flatly refused and related events in a letter to his sister. Quote, "If the emperor were asking for anything that belonged to me, lands, money, anything that I possessed, I should not refuse him a thing, although all my possessions belong to the poor. But things divine are not the property of the emperor. If you must have my patrimony, take it. If it is my person, here it is. Is it your wish to cast me in irons, then lead me to execution? I accept everything with joy. I will not hide behind the multitude. I will not embrace the altars, pleading for my life. I would rather be immolated for the altars." They urge that everything is lawful to the emperor, since everything belongs to him. And to this I reply, "Do not think, O emperor, that you have any imperial right over things divine. Do not advance such pretensions, and if you desire a long reign, submit yourself to God. It is written, 'To God what is God's, to Caesar what is Caesar's.' to the emperor, the palaces, to the priest, the churches. The right which is allotted to you extends over the public edifices, not over the sacred ones. Unquote. Peace was eventually restored to the church. The Ambrosian Rite, named after this valiant saint, is still observed in Milan. Saint Hilary of Poitiers. The convert, Saint Hilary, circa 315 to 368 AD, became bishop of Poitiers. He courageously opposed the Arian heresy in Gaul, France, and was subsequently exiled to Turkey by the Emperor Constantinus in 356 AD. Even while in exile, St. Hilary frequently encouraged the bishops of England, France, Germany, and Switzerland to remain faithful to the teachings of the Church, and he proved himself such a thorn in the side of the Arians and the semi-Arians of the East that they persuaded the emperor to send him back to Gaul or France. Though many clergy fell prey to Arianism, most of the laity in the West remained faithful due to the efforts of Christ champions. Numerous tracts were written by saintly bishops from both East and West to refute Arianism and defend their flocks from the virulent ravages of heresy. In spite of prolonged and bitter persecution, the Catholics were marching on to final victory. New champions of the Nicene faith were rising up everywhere. In the East, the most renowned of these were St. Basil, his brother St. Gregory of Nyssa, and his intimate friend St. Gregory of Nazianzus. The death of Arius. Bishop Alexander of Constantinople, who was commanded to receive Arius into the church in 336 AD, prayed that either he or Arius die before such a sacrilege occur. Canon Howe describes this event in Stories from the Catechist. Quote, "The frightful death of Arius is a terrible example of just anger of God against the teachers of false doctrine. He had many followers and powerful support, and even secured that he should be solemnly received again into the church. On the day appointed, a great procession was formed in Constantinople, and with songs of triumph, Arius was led toward the church, boasting of the victory that he had gained over the bishops. Then, suddenly, he was seized with frightful spasms, which compelled him to retire till he should be able to resume his journey. Time passed away, and he did not reappear. His followers became alarmed and at length went to his room. There was a fearful sight awaited them. Arius lay stretched on the ground, his face pale and livid, his body stiff in death, and the floor covered with his blood and intestines. His body had burst asunder, like that of Judas." Arian Bishop Eusebius of Nicomedia. Following Arius's death, Bishop Eusebius of Nicomedia became the powerful leader of the Arians, who are now called the Eusebians. He banished the traditional Catholic bishops of Chalcedon, Nicaea, and Nicomedia, and worked tirelessly to keep Arianism alive. All the most powerful churches of Eastern Christendom, and by the commencement of the reign of Constantinus, AD 337, had been brought under the influence of the Arians. Constantinople, Heraclea, Adrianople, Ephesus, and Syria, both Caesariuses, Antioch, Laodicea, and Alexandria. Eustathius of Antioch was exiled to Philippi with many priests and deacons of his church. Eusebius's plan was threefold. First, to slander and depose St. Athanasius, the fearless opponent of Arianism. And second, to deceive the masses by replacing Catholic bishops with Arians. Third, to use Catholic theological terms and alter them in such a way that, with a very little outward change in wording, they were given a completely different meaning. Thus, unwittingly at time, bishops, priests, and laity became engulfed in the Arian heresy. This method is similar to that used today by the new church formed after Vatican II. M's Cosin's Handbook of Heresies describes the turmoil caused by Arius. So great was the dispute engendered by Arius and his friends, some bishops adopting his heresy, others excommunicating him and his adherents, while others, deceived by his use of orthodox terms, scarcely knew which party to encourage, that the whole East was in a ferment and it became necessary to convoke a council of the whole church. How could so many bishops and priests imbibe these heretical doctrines? Some may have used this controversy as a means for their own material gain and ecclesiastical promotion. Acceptance by their peers and financial security were seemingly more important to such clergy than the salvation of souls and doctrinal integrity. Others may have lacked a deep faith and solid prayer life. The mutated forms of Arianism. The First Council of Nicaea used the Greek word homoousion, in Latin consubstantialis, to state that Jesus was of one substance, consubstantial, with God the Father. Arians used the Greek term homoiousion to state that Jesus was only like God. By adding the single Greek letter iota to homoousion, the Arians cleverly changed the entire meaning of the word. Arianism was like a cancer that often mutated in order to survive. Three common variations of Arianism in the two similar heresies are listed below. Homoiousion, like the father Arius, Homoios, Acacius of Caesarea. B. Anomoios, unlike the father, Aetus of Antioch. C. Homoousios, like in substance of the father, Basil of Ancyria, semi-Arianism. D. Macedonianism, denied the divinity of both Jesus Christ and the Holy Ghost, Macedonius, the Bishop of Constantinople. E. Apollinarianism, taught that Jesus lacked a rational soul. This is from Apollinarius, the younger Bishop of Laodicea. Apollinarius, who developed his heresy about 360 A.D., was never reconciled to the church. Although at one time Apollinarianism had many followers in Constantinople, Phoenicia, and Syria, it quickly faded into oblivion by 393 A.D. Persecution is renewed. Constantine was baptized on his deathbed by the Arian bishop Eusebius of Nicomedia in 337 A.D. His vast empire was subsequently divided among his sons. Constans, who was a nominal Catholic, ruled the West from 340 to 350 A.D. Constantinius II, a fervent Arian, ruled the East and later the West also. Constantius sought to make Arianism the first official religion of the empire. He convened numerous pseudo-councils that attacked the divinity of Christ through ambiguous terminology, thereby deceiving both clergy and laity alike. Other means were employed to ensure compliance: the burning of churches and monasteries, defamation, exile, imprisonment, beheading, and death. Saint Athanasius, Patriarch of Alexandria, Paul, Patriarch of Constantinople, and Lucius, Bishop of Adrianople, were among the exiled. They traveled to Rome and laid the matter before Pope St. Julius I, who restored them to their rightful sees. However, their victory would be short-lived. In defiance of the Pope's action, Eastern bishops held a council in Antioch in 341 A.D. that turned violent. St. Athanasius and Paul, the patriarchs of Constantinople, fled in fear of their lives. Paul was later strangled and replaced by the heretic Macedonius. Lucius, bishop of Adrianople, died in prison. Councils at Serdica. In order to settle various doctrinal and juridical disputes between East and West, Pope St. Julius I convoked a council to be held at Serdica, which is Sofia, Bulgaria, a city within Constans' domain in the year 343 A.D. The Easterners, however, withdrew when the Western bishops insisted on seating St. Athanasius and other bishops who had been deposed in the East by the Arians. Under the presidency of Osius, the council proceeded without them, reaffirming the validity of Athanasius's claim to the See of Alexandria and ratifying the teaching of the Council of Nicaea by forbidding the use of Arian language. The council also made provision for bishops condemned or deposed by provincial synods to appeal to Rome in order to honor the memory of Blessed Peter. The Latin bishops who attended the Council of Serdica drafted a profession of faith and approved canons that recognized the papacy as the supreme court of appeal. This action publicly acknowledged the pope's jurisdiction over the universal church. These bishops were also exonerated, St. Athanasius, and the other Catholic bishops who defended Nicaea and were excommunicated by the Arians. Clergy who previously accused St. Athanasius of various crimes repented and were received into the church by Pope St. Julius I. The rift between East and West grew progressively wider during the council as the doctrinal and jurisdictional disputes could not be resolved. The Eusebian bishops stormed out of the council and held a rival council of their own at Philippopolis, Plovdiv in Bulgaria, a city named after Alexander the Great's father, King Philip of Macedonia. The Western group, however, remained at Serdica, excommunicated the Eastern leaders, confirmed the Nicaeum, the teachings of the First Council of Nicaea, rejected the Anomois, and inserted in their letters addressed to all churches the doctrine of consubstantiality. Catholic bishops taught that Christ is the Son of God by nature, and that Christians become holy through God's grace. St. Robert Bellarmine, in his work De Consulis et Ecclesia, wrote of a later council held at Serdica in 351 A.D., at which 300 Eastern bishops confirmed the Catholic faith, while 76 Eastern bishops subscribed to the Arian faith. What may be surprising in this story is that the church should have been so vulnerable to, in what mattered most, its faith. Cardinal Newman expressed his astonishment that eminent bishops did not see what was at stake, even though the faithful sensed it. Despite the excessive caution of Pope Liberius, the Nicene faith was saved by the convergence of the faith of the people with that of the few clear-headed and courageous bishops. It was saved against power and the friends of power, against the clever, the cunning, and the submissive. The like of it has not been seen again on the same scale, though it is not perhaps ruled out of the future of the church. Pseudo-councils subsequent to the First Council of Nicaea. At some of them, heretical councils, the Arians turned to strong-arm tactics. The decrees issued were simply heretical. Meeting after meeting ended in this fashion. The whole question now centered about the Nicene Creed. Should it be accepted or not? At one gathering at Milan, the Arian bishop became so enraged that they dragged the pen from the hand of the Bishop of Milan as he was about to sign the creed. A veritable riot resulted. The emperor finally intervened and forced the bishops to condemn Athanasius, to reject Nicaea, and receive the Arians in full union with the church. The great episcopal sees were held by semi-Arians, Lisbon, Arles, Ravenna, and Sirmium in the west, Alexandria, Jerusalem, Caesarea, Antioch, Nicomedia, and Constantinople in the east. The situation in the church was bleak. Some bishops at the Council of Sirmium, Mitrovica in Yugoslavia, spoke of the eternal emperor but denied the divinity of Jesus Christ. In council after council, the bishops gave way wholesale at Arles in 353 A.D., Milan, 355 A.D., Sirmium, 357 A.D., and most spectacularly, at the simultaneous councils of Rimini, Seleucia, 359 A.D., about the morrow of which St. Jerome, 329 to 420 A.D., wrote a celebrated phrase that the whole world woke up one morning lamenting and marveling to find itself Arian. The Second Council of Sirmium of 357 A.D. drafted a creed that absolutely subordinated God, the Son, to God, the Father. St. Hilary of Poitiers called this infamous document the blasphemy. Soon afterwards, Bishop Hosius of Cordova, who was 101 years old, was imprisoned, scourged, and racked for not accepting the belief of the Arians. Under duress, he finally capitulated and signed a document that promoted Arianism. Catholic bishops from Gaul and Africa protested his action, and he subsequently recanted on his deathbed 2 years later. Meanwhile, Arian and semi-Arian bishops controlled every major diocese in the East. To further control the clergy, Constantius, convoked a council for Western bishops at Rimini in Italy and one for Eastern bishops at Seleucia in Turkey. There were no representatives of the Pope invited to these councils, and 80 Arian bishops at Rimini held the assembly in an iron grip. There were only 12 Catholics among the 150 bishops who attended the Council of Seleucia. Following a complicated series of intrigues on the part of the Arian bishops and ruthless coercion by Constantius, nearly 400 bishops from the West and 150 of the East gave their consent to the new Arian creed. This heretical creed stated that the Son of God is like the Father, not of like substance with the Father, just like. Speaking generally, the Catholic people, says Newman, in the length and the breadth of Christendom, were the obstinate champions of Catholic truth, and the bishops were not. Pope Liberius, 352 to 366 A.D., was exiled by the emperor for his opposition to the Arian heresy. In response to the imperial sentence, the pope replied, "The laws of the church are more important than residence in Rome." Constantius installed an antipope in Rome named Felix II, 355 to 356 A.D. The populace rejected the usurper, and consequently his churches were empty. With the Roman public clamoring for Liberius's return, the emperor therefore upon allowed him to go back to Rome, but on the condition that he jointly rule with the antipope Felix. This absurd compromise was not acceptable to the Romans because they recognized Liberius as the legitimate pope. Felix then fled the city. To further add to the confusion, the anti-pope Felix II was succeeded by the anti-pope Ursinus, 366 to 384 AD, whose illegitimate reign paralleled that of the Liberius successor, Pope St. Damascus I. The circumstances of Liberius' return are clouded with historical dispute, for many authorities have agreed that the harassed man, in the plight of his exile and the weariness of his advanced age, did eventually sign his name to a document insufficiently explicit against Arian doctrine. Whether he did or not may be the subject of argument, but what remains clear is there is no evidence of any kind to prove he ever taught or approve the teaching of any part of the Arian philosophy which differed from the Catholic faith. Even though opponents of papal infallibility have repeatedly cited the so-called fall of the Pope Liberius to defend their erroneous position, the capitulation of Liberius does not really bear on the question. Liberius, at the time of his fall, taught nothing and imposed no belief. Besides, if the people is to teach ex cathedra, common sense requires that he be free. Father Murthy, in General Councils of the Church, clarifies Liberius' question. Liberius continued to insist upon a free council, but his wishes were not heeded. Instead, there came forth from Sirmium, the villa of the imperial court, one formula after another, more or less Arian in tone. The first such formula had passed over the word homoousion entirely. The second was an obvious Arian decree, an open denial of Nicaea, and the third was something of a compromise, but understood in proper fashion, it could be viewed as in agreement with Nicaea. The signature of Liberius was needed, of course, to give real force to these formulas, and to this day historians debate whether Liberius signed any of the formulas, and if so, which one he did sign. Whatever did take place, it is certain enough that Liberius was, in point of fact, a staunch defender of Nicaea and also of Athanasius, which then meant the same thing. If he signed any, it would seem that it was the third formula which admits of a proper interpretation. If he signed the second, however, it is clear from his other actions that he was tricked into it. In any event, it raises no special problem in regard to papal infallibility, since Liberius never clearly issued a solemn statement on his own authority. Liberius is the first pope of the early church not listed as a saint, and although historians and theologians concur that Liberius was a weak pope, he never taught heresy. Pope St. Anastasius the First, 399-401 A.D., confirms this fact in his letter to Bishop Venerius of Milan, found in Denziger 93. Pope Liberius was also instrumental in receiving many Arians back into the church. Julian the Apostate. Emperor Constantinus was baptized on his deathbed in 361 A.D. by an Arian, and was succeeded by his cousin Julian the Apostate, who reigned for 20 months. Julian revived paganism and sought to divide the church by returning exiled bishops back to their sees, causing Arians and Catholics to battle each other. His efforts backfired as Catholics became stronger and Arians converted. The apostate emperor even attempted to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem, but his efforts were thwarted by fire and earthquakes. He died as a result of an arrow wound he received during a cavalry charge against the Persians. It is claimed by some authors that Julian collected the blood flowing from his wound in the hollow of his hand and tossed it to the sky with the exclamation, "Gallian, thou hast conquered." Emperor Valens. Julian's successor, the Arian Emperor Valens, 364-378 A.D., persecuted both Catholics and semi-Arians. As a result of these persecutions, many gave up their Arian or semi-Arian beliefs and returned to the Catholic faith. Semi-Arianism disappeared from ecclesiastical history by 367 A.D. Emperor Valens attended Mass in Caesarea, offered by St. Basil, 329-379 A.D., on January the 2nd, 6, 372. Such was the order and pomp in and about the sanctuary that it looked more like heaven than earth. The emperor was so moved by the majestic ceremonies and the devotion of the people that he not only ceased his persecutions, but even allowed St. Basil to fill vacancies with bishops loyal to the Catholic faith. Emperor Theodosius I. A Catholic general from Spain named Theodosius I, who became the next Eastern emperor, finally restored liberty to the church in the year 378 A.D. Yet when Theodosius came to power, the Arians dominated everywhere in the East, especially at Constantinople. The Orthodox believers in the city, Catholics, had neither bishop nor church. The new emperor, however, was a devout Catholic, and he wished to change all that. He decided, therefore, to restore the Catholics to power and expel the Arians. On February 28th, 380 A.D., Emperor Theodosius I, 379 to 395 A.D., ordered the populace within his empire to profess the Catholic faith, which the Apostle Peter had taught in days of old to the Romans, and which was now followed by Pope Damascus and by Peter, Bishop of Alexandria. This decree contained an explicit act of faith in the triune God. All churches in Constantinople previously held by Arians were returned to Catholics in May 381 A.D. All who failed to adhere to this faith were branded heretics and had all the assemblies forbidden. The churches of Constantinople were taken from the Arians, and their bishop Demophilius was deposed. Theodosius was himself present at the installation of St. Gregory Nazianzen, hailed as bishop of Constantinople in 379 A.D. by the people as the sun triumphantly lit the darkened basilica. When Gregory took charge of that see, he found very few Catholics. He made his residence in a small house where he offered the holy sacrifice of the Mass and began to teach the people the true doctrine of the Church concerning the Blessed Trinity. Before 2 years had passed, he had converted more than half the city. The First Council of Constantinople. It had been 50 years since Emperor Constantine transferred the seat of Roman power from the west to the strategically located ancient Greek city of Byzantium in the east. After being rebuilt and renamed Constantinople, now Istanbul, Turkey, it became a military and economic stronghold on the Bosphorus between Europe and Asia. Theodosius I took his stand against Arianism by holding the council in his imperial palace in Constantinople in 381 A.D. To secure a lasting peace, he finally convoked the free council that had been sought 20 or 30 years before by Pope Liberius. And in this way, the state officially broke with Arianism and for the first time in years expressed in a clear fashion its acceptance of the Nicene faith. Emperor Theodosius I convened the First Council of Constantinople on his own authority, and it is doubtful whether the Pope was consulted or even invited. The Emperor invited all the bishops of the East to attend. The fact that no Western bishops attended the sessions provides substantial evidence that they too were probably never invited. St. Damascus I was the first Pope to refer to the papacy as the Apostolic See, thereby distinguishing it from all other sees or dioceses. He was fearful of infringements on papal jurisdictions and reluctant to give approval to the council. The First Council of Constantinople began in May 381 A.D. and ended 2 months later. Among the 150 Catholic bishops who attended the council were saints Gregory Nazianzen, Meletius of Antioch, Gregory of Nyssa, Peter of Sebaste, Amphilochius of Iconium, Pelagius of Laodicea, Eulogius of Edessa, and Cyril of Jerusalem. The 36 heretical Macedonian bishops who attended the first session of the council refused to renounce their errors and departed. St. Meletius presided over the council, though he died during its sessions. He was succeeded by St. Gregory Nazianzen, 330 to 389 A.D., who was elected Bishop of Constantinople but later resigned. Nectarius, who was subsequently elected to fill the vacant office, concluded the council. The main accomplishments of the First Council of Constantinople. The Arian heresy was condemned and the faith of the First Council of Nicaea was reconfirmed. The Macedonian heresy was condemned. Maximus, the bishop who fraudulently usurped the See of Constantinople, was condemned, deposed, and banished. A summary of Catholic belief called the Nicene-Constantinopolitan Creed was approved during the First Council of Constantinople. In the Latin Church, this creed has been recited during Holy Mass on every Sunday and on major feasts since the 6th century. It clearly expresses the Catholic Catholic doctrine of the Blessed Trinity. The last addition to the Nicene-Constantinopolitan Creed took place in the year 1024 A.D. when Pope Benedict VIII added the word filioque to declare that the Holy Ghost proceeds from the Father and the Son. This word has remained a point of contention in the East up to the present time. There were seven canons enacted at the council. A. One reminded bishops to stay in their diocese and not to meddle in the affairs of other bishops. B. Another canon delineated the manner of receiving heretics back into the church. C. The third canon gave the Bishop of Constantinople preeminence over all other bishops, except the Bishop of Rome, since Constantinople was styled the New Rome. And D. Several canons condemned the Macedonian heresy, the Apollinarian heresy, and Arianism in all its forms. Since Constantinople was styled the New Rome, the third canon of the council placed the Bishop of Constantinople above all other bishops, although the Pope would continue to be acknowledged as the supreme head of the Church. This novel idea was contrary to the customary practice of the Church, dating back to apostolic times, of placing Alexandria and Antioch above Constantinople because of their special relationship with St. Mark and St. Peter. Canon 5 of the Fourth Lateran Council of 1215 later accepted this new order of precedence. Michael Walsh, in his book, The Popes, writes, quote, "The See of Alexandria had, according to tradition, been founded by St. Mark, Peter's disciple, and because Peter presided over the See of Antioch for a time before moving on to Rome, these churches were to rank second and third. And, as extra proof of Rome's preeminence, if more were needed, the council, the one Pope St. Damascus I called at Rome in 382 A.D., pointed out that a second apostle, St. Paul, had been associated with Peter in founding the church in the empire's capital city of Rome. Constantinople came nowhere. Ecclesiastical status was not to depend upon civil status as far as the authority of the local church was concerned," unquote. The First Council of Constantinople differs from all other general councils of the Church, since it was not approved by the reigning pontiff, but by subsequent popes and by the Council of Chalcedon in 451 A.D. In the West, Pope Gregory the Great, following the example of Pope Vigilius and Pope Pelagius II, recognized it as an ecumenical council, but only in its dogmatic utterances, by which the true doctrine of the divinity of the Holy Ghost was defined, and heresies denying this article were condemned. Great trials for the Church. Unfortunately, the First Council of Constantinople did not deliver the death blow to Arianism. Toward the end of the 4th century, the Burgundians and the Lombards became Arians. The greater part of the Germanic tribes adopted Christianity in its Arian form, and in many places right up to the 6th century, alongside the Catholic parishes, there were Arian parishes with their own churches and baptistries. Meanwhile, the Arian Vandals and the Visigoths incited great persecutions of the Church. Things looked so bleak that many, unmindful of God's protection of the Catholic Church, predicted its ultimate demise. Quote, "With the coming of the barbarians, the Catholic Church fell on evil days, since the Goths and the Vandals were Arians, having been converted by Arian Bishop Ulfilas, died 383. Wherever they took over, they persecuted the Catholics. Hunneric, the Vandal rule in Africa in 484, summoned the 466 Catholic bishops to a meeting with their Arian colleagues. At its conclusion, his edict was read, which prohibited all assemblies of Catholics, confiscated their churches, and drove the bishops out of their sees. The Visigoths in Spain all severely restricted the freedom of the subjugated Gallo-Roman Catholic populace. Everywhere, in fact, the Gallo-Roman Catholic populace was under the sway of the persecuting Arian conquerors." Posidius writes of St. Augustine seeing, in the early years of the Vandal invasion, towns ruined, people murdered and driven to flight, churches without clergy, maidens dedicated to God wandering about, homeless or suffering in intolerable servitude, the sacraments disregarded or asked for in vain, refugees pursued in their way in their very hiding places or dying of want, and the leaders of the churches stretching out their hands for help where there was none. Life of Augustine, chapter 25-28. And to all of this was soon added the demand for apostasy to Arianism, in response to which there were many martyrs, direct and indirect. The demise of Arianism. Saint Clotilda, a Burgundian princess, was instrumental in converting her husband Clovis, king of the Franks. He was baptized by Saint Remigius at Reims in France in 496 AD, together with 3,000 of his soldiers. A great miracle occurred during this historical event. Quote, Hincmar of Reims, who wrote the life of Saint Remigius in the 9th century, is the first to mention a legend that at the baptism of Clovis, the chrism for the anointing was found to be missing, whereupon St. Remigius prayed, and a dove appeared from the heavens, bearing in its beak an ampulla of chrism. A phial of oil, fallible to be the same, was preserved at the Abbey of St. Remy and used in the consecration of kings of France until Charles X in 1825. It was broken up at the French Revolution, but a piece of La Sainte Ampoule and its contents were saved and are kept in Reims Cathedral. In 507 AD, Clovis defeated the Visigoths and killed Alaric II, king of the Visigoths, at the Battle of Vouliez near Tours. Clovis then conquered or pacified the remaining tribes and became the sole ruler of the Franks. Then, taking into account the political views which still animated his Roman subjects, Clovis had the incumbent emperor of the Roman Empire of the East, Anastasius, confer on him the title Patricius, and thus had his rule in Gaul recognized by the highest authority then existing. Many Arians then converted to Catholicism, and the last vestiges of Arianism finally faded into oblivion on the plains of Lombardy in 744 A.D., The Arian heresy had persisted for over 400 years, but like all heresies, faded in time and disappeared. The triumph of the faith, envisioned by the First Council of Nicaea and the First Council of Constantinople, was at last fulfilled. Chapter 3, The Council of Ephesus, 431 AD. This council was held during the pontificate of by Pope St. Celestine I. Background. During the 4th and 5th centuries, the Huns, the Vandals, Visigoths, Ostrogoths, and other marauding bands of barbarian tribes ravaged the continent of Europe, causing violent upheaval. The Roman Empire was in shambles, and geopolitical and economic stability were non-existent. The turmoil increased with new external and internal attacks on the Church. Shortly before the Council of Ephesus began, the antipope Eulalius reigned from the city of Rome until he was forcibly expelled by the imperial troops of the Western Emperor. New heresies arose, making the anarchy complete. The heretics Pelagius and Soelestius. The Council of Ephesus was convoked to condemn the heresies of Pelagius and Nestorius. In the year 400 AD, an English monk, Pelagius, led multitudes astray by his heretical teachings concerning grace and justification. Pelagius taught that natural goodness was sufficient for salvation, divine grace was not necessary. Pelagius possessed many traits of the heretic Arius: intelligence, eloquence, and craftiness. A Scottish monk named Coelestius assisted him in his diabolical work. Father St. John Lowe in Church History states, quote, "In order to deceive their bearers, their hearers, and readers, Pelagius and Coelestius made use of Christian terms such as baptism, original sin, grace, redemption, but attached entirely different meanings to them, much like the modernists of today." Quote, "After the sack of Rome by Alaric in 410 AD, Pelagius and Coelestius fled to Carthage, where Coelestius remained for some years, while Pelagius passed over to Palestine. Coelestius was condemned by a council held at Carthage in 411 AD. Pelagius succeeded in deceiving a number of eastern bishops and for a time maintained his ground against all opposition. In Jerusalem, he won over hundreds of monks who were ready even to use violence to propagate his terror or to quash the arguments of his opponents. Banished by Emperor Honorius from the Western Empire, Pelagius and Coelestius found an asylum with Nestorius, Bishop of Constantinople, and along with him they were condemned by the Council of Ephesus in 431. Unquote. Pope Innocent I excommunicated Pelagius and Coelestius because of their erroneous teachings. St. Augustine, Bishop of Hippo Regius, Annaba, Algeria, was an eloquent orator and a dauntless fighter against the Pelagian heresy. His writings clearly explain the proper relationship between free will and the grace of God. Justification takes place not through man alone, as Pelagius taught, nor through man and God, as the more moderate amongst his followers, semi-Pelagians, maintain, but through God and man, as the Catholic Church teaches. St. Augustine also strongly opposed other heresies prevalent at the time, including Manicheism and Donatism. The heretic Nestorius. Emperor Theodosius II died 450 A.D., appointed Nestorius, a conceited monk from Antioch, to serve as a bishop of Constantinople in the year 428 A.D. Nestorius was born in Syria, though his parents were Persian. And like Arius, he studied theology at Antioch, where he became a famous preacher. The new bishop taught that there were two distinct persons in Jesus Christ, God the Son and Jesus of Nazareth the man. Nestorius also claimed that God dwelt in Jesus as in a temple and that he became God by degrees. According to Nestorius, the Blessed Virgin Mary was only the mother of the man Christ and therefore should not be called the mother of God. On the contrary, Catholic theology teaches that Jesus Christ is only one person with two distinct natures, the divine nature of God and the human nature of man. The second person of the Blessed Trinity became incarnate in the womb of the Blessed Virgin Mary at the moment of conception. Our Lady conceived and brought forth the Son of God made man. Therefore, the Blessed Virgin Mary is rightly called the Mother of God because her Son is God. The whole Nestorian controversy came to a head in the year 428 A.D. when Anastasius, a disciple of Nestorius, preached that Mary should not be called the Mother of God. The clergy and laity who heard the sermon were shocked and appalled. When they complained of it to the bishop, Nestorius not only refused to condemn the teaching, but he made use of the opportunity to set forth the doctrine himself. When the monks of Constantinople, deeply devoted to Mary, protested before the patriarch, they were imprisoned and scourged. Nestorius himself extended the controversy by publishing his sermons far and wide. Father John Murphy assures us that the title Mother of God was already held dear by the faithful. Quote, "For many years now, the faithful had spoken of the Blessed Mother as the Theotokos, or the Mother of God. There are indications of its use in prayers as early as the 3rd century. Nestorius now claimed that this was a dangerous word. He held that we ought to speak of Mary only as the mother of Christ. Thus, the defense of the true doctrine concerning Christ was necessarily linked so intimately to the honor given to Mary as his mother. One cannot dishonor Mary without dishonoring Christ as well, and those who heard Nestorius preach realized this. Saint Cyril of Alexandria. Saint Cyril, Bishop of Alexandria, circa 376 to 444 AD, soon received news of the controversy in Constantinople. In response, he wrote a number of articles defending the doctrine of the Incarnation. These pastoral letters were sent throughout Egypt, and some found their way to Constantinople. Quote, Cyril's writings were eagerly read in Constantinople to the great discomfiture and chagrin of Nestorius, who had won high favor at the imperial court. Cyril, in his clear exposition of the Incarnation, informed the emperor and the imperial family of the new heresy. Obligated by the old custom of the church, Cyril reported the heretical teachings of Nestorius to Pope Celestine I. Nestorius also had written to the Pope, putting the blame of the whole controversy on Cyril, and he recommended in his letter to the Pope that the term Mother of Christ should be the golden mean between Mother of God and Mother of Man. Unquote. Pope St. Celestine I convoked a synod in Rome in the year 430 AD to examine the writings and the teaching of Nestorius. The synod declared that Nestorius was to be excommunicated and deposed until he renounced his heresy. The Council of Ephesus. The grandest of ancient cities of Turkey is Ephesus. St. Paul spent 2 years in Ephesus, ministering to a small Christian community, and later wrote them an epistle from captivity. Shortly after the death of Christ, St. John the Evangelist and the Blessed Virgin Mary had lived in this city. Our Lady always held a special place in the hearts of Ephesians because she had taught them the rudiments of Christianity. Emperor Theodosius II convoked a general council to be held in the port city of Ephesus in order to resolve the Nestorian problem. It was scheduled to begin on the Feast of Pentecost, 431 AD. Pope St. Celestine I responded to the emperor by sending 3 legates with specific instructions to the modus operandi of the council. Quote, first of all, they were to attach themselves firmly to Cyril of Alexander, who would serve as their guide. Second, they were to safeguard the rights of the Bishop of Rome. They were to come as judges, not as parties to a controversy. The Bishop of Rome had already settled the question of Nestorius and his teaching. They were simply to make sure that this was carried out. Owing to this directive, the council produced some of the most outstanding testimony of the century to the Roman primacy, since the bishops gave vocal expression to their acceptance of papal authority. Lastly, considering the difficulty of traveling in those days, the legates were told that, should they arrive late, they were to investigate carefully everything that had taken place before their arrival. As time would prove, this was a bit of advice well given. Unquote. Among the bishops in attendance, 50 came with St. Cyril of Alexandria, 40 came with Menum, the Bishop of Ephesus, 15 came with the Bishop of Jerusalem, 12 came from Pamphylia, and 6 bishops were associated with Nestorius. Nestorius, who had resided in Ephesus since Easter, was not well liked by the local populace. He requested an imperial bodyguard composed of a group of gladiators. St. Cyril brought a contingent of sailors from Alexandria for his own protection. Quote, when the appointed day arrived, the papal legates had not yet arrived, and the patriarch of Antioch, John, who had been appointed by the emperor to preside, was also absent. In John's case, the delay may have been on purpose. He was a friend of Nestorius and may not have wished to take part in the condemnation. At any rate, he did send word that they ought not to wait too long should he be delayed. After 16 days of waiting, St. Cyril of Alexandria determined it was time to begin. He therefore took upon himself to preside over the first session of the Council of Ephesus on June 22, 431 AD. Nestorius was officially summoned to the council three times, but he obstinately refused to attend. Nevertheless, the council proceeded with its important work. Letters written by Pope St. Celestine I and St. Cyril condemning Nestorius were read to the council fathers. Cyril's treatise describing the union of the two natures in one person in Christ, also called the hypostatic union, was read and approved. Writings of the early fathers of the church were also read, confirming the teachings of Pope St. Celestine I and St. Cyril. The Nicene Creed was recited, and the bishops professed their adherence to the teachings of the First Council of Nicaea. The Council Fathers publicly read 20 extracts from the writings of Nestorius, and his heretical teachings were formally condemned. Nestorius was excommunicated and deposed. Eyewitnesses described the joyful scene that resulted from the proclamations. And this is the end of side two. It will be continued on side three.